Today, I am going to speak about discharge of contract by breach. What is meant by breach? Generally, breach means under Contract Act, it is a contravention of the terms and conditions that have to be strictly complied with by the parties to the agreement. So, whenever any one of the parties under the agreement either fails to discharge his obligation according to the terms of the contract, or any person who exercises his right in contravention to the terms and conditions of the agreement, such party is said to have committed a breach of contract. Now, generally, in common sense, breach means where water in a river overflows the defined channel and breaks the bond. So, that is what is known as breach. Similarly, the parties in an agreement, they should discharge their rights and obligations according to the terms and conditions of the contract. If any of the parties, either while exercising the right, exercises such right in excess, or if any party fails to discharge his obligation, such party or parties are said to have acted in contravention to the terms and conditions of the agreement. That is what is known as breach. Now, so far as breach is concerned, there are three possible ways under which a breach may take place. Number one, breach may occur at the time when performance has become due. Breach may occur while performing the contract. Third, breach may occur even before performance of the contract take place. In other words, I should say, a breach that is going to be committed in future may be intimated by the respective parties to the other well in advance. Before the due date of performance, the promisor who has got to perform his obligation may intimate the other party that he will not be in a position to perform the contract, fulfill the obligations under the contract. So these are the three possible ways under which we may have to study breach of contract. First, breach may occur when performance has become due. I have earlier mentioned that breach is likely to take place, which may be intimated or which may take place at the time when performance has become due. Earlier we said time with regard to delivery is considered to be the essence of the contract. Breach occurs at the time when performance has become due in all these cases. Where time with regard to delivery is considered to be the essence of the contract, that is what material management rather gives great emphasis with regard to supply of materials on time. Just in time, that is what is known as JIT, that is the technical word they use. There must be synchronization of supply of materials and the manufacturing program. In order to ensure that manufacturing program is not impeded or disturbed, they actually have a technique known as ordering level. When a level actually arrives at a particular point, immediately the management will actually apply for supply of materials. They will place an order for supply of materials. Why? Because the time on which the order is placed and the time at which the materials may be supplied, there will be an interval. During that interval, the factory should not suffer for want of materials. So, they will arrange the program in such a way that the materials available with them should be sufficient so as to withstand this period of lien, this lien period, that is the date on which they are placed on order, the date on which supply is going to be effected. So there should not be a sort of lull, or there should not be any gap in which period there won't be any work if materials are not available. So that is the reason as to why, to ensure continuity of work, they will actually place the order when once the materials have reached a particular level. So this is what is known as ordering level. So that is the concept in material management. But here, so far as section 55 under the Contract Act is concerned, it envisages the various possibilities with regard to fulfillment of obligations, namely supply of materials with regard to the manufacturing program. In other words, in general sense, this particular aspect can be used for any transactions. Time with regard to delivery is considered to be the essence of the contract under section 55. What are the various provisions that are actually found under section 55 of the Contract Act? If goods are not delivered at the stipulated time, what is the option that is left open to the promisee, the person who is entitled to receive these materials? He can actually put an end to the contract. He can repudiate, he can rescind, he can cancel the particular contract. He can say, in as much as you have supplied beyond the time, as you have not supplied at the stipulated time, I don't want these materials to be supplied. I am cancelling the contract. So, time with regard to delivery is considered to be the essence of the contract. Therefore, when belatedly the materials are supplied, the other party who is entitled to receive the materials, he can put an end to the contract or rescind the contract. So, there is the first option under section 55. The second option that is left to the promisee is, when the promisor actually supplies the goods belatedly, nothing will prevent the promisee from accepting the goods by raising his finger of protest. He will definitely receive the materials under protest, reserving his right to file a suit for damages. He can claim damages for belated supply of materials. So, nothing prevents the promisee to receive the goods and reserve his right to file a suit for damages. That is the second option. The third option that is left is, where the promisee has received the goods without raising his little finger of protest, if he has not protested, if he has kept quiet and he has received the goods, later on he cannot file a suit for recovery of damages. That is the third instance. The fourth instance is, where nothing is stipulated with regard to time in respect of delivery of goods or in respect of fulfillment of obligations, the law envisages that such obligations must be fulfilled within a reasonable time. What is a reasonable time? A reasonable time depends upon the facts and circumstances of the case. So, time with regard to delivery is considered to be the essence of the contract, though not time with regard to payment of price. Time with regard to payment of price can never be the essence of the contract. Under Section 11 of the Sale of Goods Act, even if the goods are belatedly supplied, he is entitled to recover damages, recover interest. He is entitled to recover interest. Equally, if payment of price is delayed by the purchaser to the seller can recover the ruling rate of interest at that time when the breach has been committed by the purchaser in respect of payment of price. So, under the Sale of Goods Act, under Section 11, the price can be paid with interest if any delay has occurred either on the part of the seller or on the part of the purchaser. So time with regard to payment of price is not essence of the contract under the Sale of Goods Act. But there are exceptional instances where when the transaction pertains to the sale of gold, silver and diamonds, where the prices used to fluctuate. So in such cases, time with regard to payment of price becomes the essence of the contract, which we shall see when we talk about the Sale of Goods Act. So these are all the things which you have got to study as regards breach in respect of breach that there is due and likely to occur. Breach may occur at the time when performance becomes due. So the first instance is where the person who is entitled to receive the materials can in toto reject the contract. Second, he can receive the goods and reserve his right to file claim for damages. Third, where the contract, it's where the person promisee is silent when he receives the goods without raising any objection, he is deemed to have waived his right with regard to claim for damages. Fourth is that, you see, within a reasonable time, the goods must be supplied. This is the instance where breach may occur at the time when performance becomes due. The second instance is breach may occur while performing the contract. There are two cases, Ben versus Burness and Bittany versus Guy. These are the two leading cases which we should be aware of. So in the first case, Ben versus Burness, in that particular case, a charter party agreement was entered into between the charterer and the ship owner. Charter is taking a ship on lease under an agreement. That is what is known as charter party agreement. In all cases where the charterer, namely the person who wants to take lease of an entire ship, he is not actually taking the ship on lease, but he is taking the space available in the ship on lease, on hire, so that he can actually export the goods and send to the place of destinations. So here, whenever a charter party agreement has to be entered into, it is very essential they must indicate in the charter party agreement the place where the ship has been berthed, or the shape, the place where the ship has been anchored. So in this particular case, Ben versus Burness, the ship has been shown under the charter party agreement to have been berthed or anchored at Amsterdam on a particular date. On that date, the ship was not at all anchored at Amsterdam. The ship was found elsewhere. You know why? The reason as to why the indication of the place where the ship has been berthed or anchored must be indicated in the agreement is, the importer has got to calculate time. He has got to actually assess the time that the ship will take to touch the port of importation. So he has got to calculate the time and keep ready the cargo on the wharf, so that the moment the ship comes, they must be able to load the cargo on the ship, so that there may not be any sort of demurrage. Demurrage means where if the ship is delayed for more than the stipulated period during which the exportation and importation to take place, if it is delayed, then there will be demurrage. So that is the reason as to why they want the place where the ship has been anchored or berthed to be indicated in the charter party agreement. It so happened that this was not indicated. Then this was considered to be a breach of condition. So, you know, in as much as they have not actually indicated the correct place where the ship has been anchored, the particular owner of the ship was found liable for paying damages for breach of condition. The next case is Bittany versus Guy. These are all instances where breach may occur while performance is taking place. So in Bittany versus Guy, a playback singer entered into a contract with a broadcasting company. This broadcasting company, under its rules, have specified that if any program has to be conducted in that particular station, broadcasting station, it is rather necessary, it is incumbent on the part of the singer or performer to undergo rehearsals. In this particular music program, they wanted to have rehearsals for 5 days. But the particular participant who actually participated in the music concert, she came only 3 days for rehearsals and she did not turn up for 2 days. As a consequence of which, there was a gross violation of the rules and conditions. Thereupon, the particular broadcasting station authorities cancelled the contract, in as much as she attended only for 3 days rehearsals. The broadcasting authorities, they actually cancelled the contract with that particular musician to participate, who has to participate in the concert. Then she filed a suit that the broadcasting company has no authority to cancel. Then she filed a suit for breach of warranty. The court said this is a case where they ought to have actually pay the damages, because you see, they cannot cancel the contract. The broadcasting authorities cannot cancel. They can only, they in turn also can file a suit for breach of warranty. They have got to file a suit for violating the rules of the broadcasting station, namely that the participant should attend at least 5 rehearsals before broadcasting the program. So, in as much as she has failed to fulfill these conditions, the only way is that they can only file a suit for damage, if at all they actually sustain any loss. But here, in this case, the participant was allowed to file a suit for breach of warranty for cancelling the program and then insisting that she has not actually attended the 3 days, the 2 days rehearsals and cancelled the program. So, this was considered to be the next case you find. Then these are all instances where breach occurs at that while performing the contract. Breach may occur, breach, the occurrence of breach, because breach will not occur because it is only an intimation about the future commitment of breach. So this is a case where before occurrence of the breach, the party who is under obligation to perform the contract, he informs well in advance that he or she will not be in a position to fulfill the contract on the date, on the due date of performance. This is what is known as anticipatory breach of contract under Section 39 of the Contract Act. What is anticipatory breach of contract? A breach that is going to occur on the due date of performance is well intimated in advance by the party who is under obligation to perform the contract. This is what is known as anticipatory breach of contract. Now, in anticipatory breach of contract, when such intimation is given to the promisee, to the party who is entitled to receive the performance, if he is intimated that the party who is under obligation will not be able to perform the contract, then what the other party promisee should do, immediately he should accept the position, he should accept her intimation and rescind the contract. Rescind the contract means cancel the contract, and then he should file a suit for damages on the ground of anticipatory breach of contract. This is what is known as anticipatory breach of contract. A breach that is going to occur on due date of performance is anticipated well in advance. In as much as he has received the intimation well in advance, before the due date of performance, he can rescind the contract and file a suit for damages. This is what is known as breach for anticipatory breach of contract, could be also be claimed by way of damages. Damages could be claimed even for anticipatory breach of contract. But there is a legal argument on this score. Anticipated breach of contract, that is the breach that is going to occur on due date of performance, is anticipated well in advance, and the other party who is entitled to receive the performance, he files a suit for damages. You may ask the question, under the Contract Act, damages means the loss. Loss must be proved factually. There can be no suit for claiming loss unless it is proved factually. So loss has got to be proved. That is why it is dealing with liquidated damages. Liquidated damages mean the quantum of damages that has got to be rightly measured, assessed and budgeted. So you cannot make a tall claim with regard to recovery of damages. What is actually the loss you have incurred? In as much as the performance itself is due only on a future date, and when the party who is to perform the obligation, when he intimates well in advance, in what way you can prove damages, in what way you can prove loss, there is no loss at all. On the other hand, the promisee is given an opportunity to avert the loss because he has been intimated well in advance. So how can he file a suit for damages on anticipatory breach of contract? Now here, the point is, though the intimation with regard to breach may be intimated earlier in advance, still the promisee has got to make alternate arrangements. He has got to find out other sources from where he could actually see that the contract is actually performed. So for that he may incur expenses. Now, if we say like that, you will not be in a position to understand. Let us actually cite a case. Hochest versus De La Tour. There is a particular case. Hochest versus De La Tour. In that particular case, a courier entered into an agreement with the traveling passengers that he will be able to take them to all places of importance in foreign countries, and he will be able to show them the importance of those places. So the courier's service was engaged, but even 2 months earlier, before the travel commenced, the voyage commenced, the agreement was entered into. But the courier, within 1 week from the date on which he was approached, intimated to the passengers that he will not be in a position to take them and guide them and show them all the places of importance during the time of voyage. So that was the intimation that was given well in advance before the due date on which the travel is to take place. So the passengers, they actually filed a suit on the ground of anticipatory breach of contract. The breach that is going to occur on the due date of performance has been intimated well in advance. They filed a suit and they were able to recover. At that particular juncture, the loss has got to be measured. How to measure the loss? How to actually assess the loss? That is the question. Now I will give you another tangible example. Supposing there is a film actress, a reputed famous film actress. The producer has entered into an agreement with that famous film actress that she has to act as a heroine in this picture. Now that picture the scenes have got to be taken in foreign countries like USA, England, France, Germany and all those places. So this particular producer engaged her to act as a heroine in his film and promised to take her commencing from April to September. So this is the agreement that has been entered into by the film producer. But this agreement was entered in the month of January. But the producer intimated even in the last week of February that he will not be in a position to take that particular lady, namely who is to act as a hero in the picture. He will not be able to take her since another lady has come into the picture and she will be more suitable for the role and all that. And therefore, he said he will not be in a position to take her to all these places for the purpose of shooting the picture. So this lady actually filed a suit for damages on the ground of anticipatory breach of contract. Then the court asked, what is the damage? What is the loss? Damage means loss. Damages means compensation, pecuniary compensation. Now the court actually posed a question before the particular lady who was actually given an impression that she will be actually taken to all foreign places to act in the picture. She filed a suit on the ground of anticipatory breach of contract. The court asked her to prove the damage, but the lady was able to prove in this particular case. She said, I have been approached by several film producers for acting in their picture on account of this particular engagement in which I have assured to accompany this producer from the month of April till the month of September to all these places in order to enable him to shoot the picture. I have actually declined and refused the other offers which had been proposed, which have come to me. These are all the offers that that have been made to me, on account of which I have lost this much of money. She was able to prove. The court granted the damages. So here you can find, even in the anticipatory breach of contract, you can prove. Because damage can be ascertained only after the due date of performance. That is the common sense. When can you prove the loss that has been occurred? Only on the due date of performance. If performance has not been made, if the particular person who has promised to perform the obligation, if he has failed to perform the obligation, then only you will be in a position to assess and quantify and measure the loss which has been sustained by you. So here, in anticipatory breach of contract, how to prove damages, how to actually prove loss? This is an instance where the film actress is able to prove that so many offers that has come to her has been refused because of the fact that he has already promised the first film producer to make a trip to all these places for the purpose of enabling him to take pictures in all the foreign countries. So this is how we can prove. Now another important point is, this is what is known as a moot point in law. That is the point that has been discussed in Avery versus Bowden. Now, in all cases of anticipatory breach of contract, where a person who has got to perform the obligation, performer, when once he has intimated to the promisee, the person who is entitled to receive performance, so when he has intimated to him that the performer will not be in a position to perform his obligation much earlier in advance, it is open to the promisee to file a suit on the ground of anticipatory breach of contract. So you will find naturally there is an interval between intimation by the performer that he will not be able to perform the obligation and the promisee who is entitled to receive the performance. There is an interval on the due date of performance and the actual date on which the performer has intimated that he will not be in a position to perform the contract. So these days are allowed so that the promisee, the person who is entitled to receive the performance, may approach the performer and request him, make some sort of request, make amends, and actually ask him to perform somehow or other the obligations which he is entitled to perform under the agreement. So which he is obliged to perform under the agreement. So he can actually persuade him. He can actually make a repeated request to him, and there is all the possibilities that there may be a revision of view and he may be prepared to perform the contract also at a later date. So that is why there is an interregnum. But in Avery versus Bowden, what happened? A merchant, that is, deputed his agent, namely a master of the ship, to receive certain consignments in the port of Odisha at Russia. English merchant has deputed a ship captain to receive goods, namely wheat, bags of wheat, to be received at the port of Odisha in Russia. So he deputed the captain. But subsequently what happened, the requirements have been cut short. So the captain of the ship, so he went there, no doubt he went, and he demanded. There is no question of reduction, but no doubt the English merchant, by a revision of thought, he decided to receive the goods which he has ordered with the Russian merchant, to supply the goods, to deliver the goods on the ship at the port of Odisha. So the captain went to the port of Odisha much earlier, 1 month ahead of the due date on which the goods have to be delivered. So he went there and demanded the Russian merchant to deliver the bags of wheat on board of the ship. Even 1 month earlier, he intimated and he made a request. The ship was anchored and he was actually requesting the Russian merchant to deliver the goods. But the Russian merchant said he will not be in a position to deliver the goods on the due date, namely on the date on which he has agreed to deliver the goods. He said, though you have come earlier, I will not be in a position to deliver the goods because I have got my own commitments I have not fulfilled. So that is the plea that he was actually raising. Now what should have been the right attitude of the agent of the English merchant, namely the captain? He should have immediately filed a suit on the ground of anticipatory breach of contract. So what happened? This particular captain, being an agent of the English merchant, went on persuading the Russian merchant to supply the goods. Somehow or other, you please fulfill your obligation. And meanwhile, what happened? War was declared between Russia and England. Now it has become more handy for the Russian merchant to take a defense by saying that in as much as war has been declared between England and Russia, I will not be in a position to supply the bags of wheat on the due date of performance. When the matter went up to court, the court also decided the case in favor of the Russian merchant, and they said that the Russian merchant has got causes which are justifiable for non-supply of these materials on the due date of performance. So, extraneous circumstances may also prevent the due performance by one party to the other if immediately action is not taken on the due date of performance. So this is the famous case cited as Avery versus Bowden. So these are the important things which you may have to note with regard to performance of the contract.